Giant Voice,
the official podcast of the U.S. Navy's largest overseas installation, Commander Fleet Activities Yokosuka. This is the Giant Voice Podcast.
Welcome back to the Giant Voice Podcast. My name is MC2 Houghtaling. I hope you're having a great day today. Today we'll be talking about a pretty broad range of subjects, all having to do with PCSing and getting to Yokosuka for the first time. So if you're nervous, if you maybe don't know what to do, where to go, this should hopefully point you to some pretty reliable resources that can help you on your journey here and make the PCS process a bit more smooth. Everybody has their kind of ups and downs when it comes to PCSing and just getting through that process. I know it was pretty hard for me too. So we've broken up the episode today into four different subjects, kind of ranging from different aspects that have to do with the PCS process. We'll be inviting a lot of experts onto the show to talk about what they know, what are some common misconceptions that people have about the PCS process. I know that there sometimes can unknowingly be a lot of misinformation that gets spread. So we're hopefully trying to curb that and focus on getting the right messages out. So our first topic today will be about contacting sponsors, and we'll be talking about the Sponsorship on Demand program. Our second topic today will be about early pet quarantine processes. Our third topic today will be about overseas medical screenings, and our last topic today will be about passport requirements and processes. And without further ado, here's our first topic. We'll be speaking about contacting sponsors and the Sponsorship on Demand program. I hope you enjoy. So for our first topic today, we'll be speaking with Shannon Miller and Lena Urena. They both work at the Fleet and Family Support Center, and we'll be speaking about sponsors and sponsorship on demand. Welcome to the show, guys.
Thank you
for having us.
Tell me a little bit about yourself. How's life been at the Fleet and Family?
Well, fine. Again, this is Lena Urena. I'm a work and family life specialist here at Fleet and Family Support Center here on CFA. I've been a military spouse for 17 years.
Wow.
But I've been with Fleet and Family for about a year or so, and we'll still be here for a little while longer, but that's it. Yeah, just here to help the families here on base and assisting our service members and our family members as much as possible.
That's nice to meet you. And
hi, I'm Shannon Miller. I have been a military spouse for 10 years, a little bit over 10 years. I've been here in Yokosuka for 5 years, and I've been working at Fleet and Family Support Center for a little over 7 months. I would say, active in the community for the entire time that I've been here, and I'm very grateful and thankful to have this job to continue to help support the families here at CFA, and just spreading the information that, you know, that the mission that Fleet and Family is supportive of, and the mission for families here in the Navy and here at CFA as well.
Nice. Well, that's what I'm hopefully here to do, help you out with. For our first question, just for the people who might not know, what is a sponsor? And if I'm getting orders, how can they help me?
Okay, so basically, a sponsor is a trained service member that assists an incoming gains adaptation to their new lifestyle here on CFA. So it's also their living environment as well as their working environment at the command. So essentially, a sponsor helps the incoming service member and their families settle in faster at their installation, but by providing information regarding housing, childcare, employment opportunities, what schooling options they'll have, what medical options are available here on base, moving with pets, cultural adaptation, as well as any other activities that are available to them here on CFA. So again, ultimately, sponsors are here to support and minimize the stress for the service member that's coming in.
Thank you very much. And when do I need to contact my sponsor?
So the incoming game will be contacted by their sponsor as soon as he or she is assigned one from the gaining command.
Got it. And, well, how do I contact the sponsor?
So during the initial contact from the gaining command sponsor, all contact information will actually be exchanged. So this will include phone numbers, emails, that way they can be in touch with each other.
Is there anyone else I should contact besides the sponsor?
The sponsor should be the incoming Gain's main point of contact. There are some other options for the incoming Gain to explore and regarding to their PCS. So the first thing is sponsorship on demand. It's a great opportunity for service members and their families to get information regarding their move. We have sponsorship on demand on the first and third Thursday of every month, starting at 08 Japan Standard Time. We have CFA department heads and representatives available through Microsoft Teams for this hour-long forum live, so they can ask questions and then get the responses and hopefully get them right the first time. There are subject matter experts available to answer those questions for the service member or the family member for their upcoming PCS. Also available and is a great resource is that Perspective Gains and their ombudsman for their command. So ombudsman can be reached, and they are an excellent resource for referrals as well. They are a point of contact that every service member and their family member should know about, as they are the link between the service member and the command and the family members. If they can't find their ombudsman, they can contact Fleet and Family Support Center, and we can get them that information as well. CFA has made a great initiative and a campaign for hashtag Welcome Aboard Yokosuka, which covers essential topics for newcomers through this podcast and a series of informative articles through my CFA Weekly as well. And then the PAO has been instrumental in updating the Welcome Aboard page through the CNIC CFA website. That has been updated with amazing information. It's right at your fingertips, links to everything that an inbound family member or a service member would need to know about coming here to Yokosuka.
Thank you very much. Last question I had before I turn over to anything you might have is how would one become a sponsor, and what does that process involve?
Well, Fleet and Family Support Center is the only outlet that service members can become sponsors. So they would need to complete training. They'll receive a verification letter from our office. Mm-hmm. And then they must be a E5 or a senior E4 on their second tour of duty, with a must promote or early promote on their most recent evaluation. As long as they're that, they can be a sponsor, obviously E5 and above.
Got it. Thank you very much. And before we turn over to the next subject, is there anything you want to add just that you think people might need to know about, anything like that? Any plugs?
Well, if you are at a command on CFA and you are interested in being a sponsor, you are more than welcome to contact us at Fleet and Family. And I can provide the general email for that. And that is fffcinfo@us.navy.mil. If you'd like to give us a call here, it's DSN 243-3372.
Yeah, definitely get your command or department request in. Lena heads and spearheads our reload program, and I assist her with it. And we have a lot of fun doing sponsorship training. We learn a lot every time we do sponsorship training. We learn, we get great questions from service members out there who are wanting to make this a fun and good collateral duty for incoming PGs and their families. It is one of the better, I think, collateral duties that a service member could have too.
Awesome. Yeah. Thank you guys so much for being on the show today.
Thank you for having
us. Thank you so much.
For our next topic today, we'll have Captain Tori Allen. How you doing?
Good. How are you?
And what are we discussing today?
We are discussing the pet import and quarantine laws for Japan.
So tell me about them. Tell me kind of what what goes all into that, especially when PCSing?
Yeah, so number one is that Japan requires that all pets that are imported into the country be quarantined for 180 days. That's not just for people who PCS, that's everyone, including Japanese citizens. And so when it comes to PCSing and you get your orders, there are a few things that you have to do in order for you to get into the country and kind of make a seamless transition.
What are some of the requirements that go into that?
So number one is the pet needs to be microchipped. We now have called ISO compliant microchips. Majority of microchips today are ISO compliant. The next step is making sure that they have two rabies vaccines. So the first rabies vaccine actually has to be done 91 days or older. It's very specific here. It's not as specific in other countries, but for Japan, it is 91 days or older. The second vaccine must be done 30 days after or in a normal rabies vaccination schedule, as long as there are no lapses. Once those are complete, they get what's called a favin, which is a rabies titer. At the time of the blood draw for the rabies titer, that begins the 180-day quarantine period. Basically, this states to Japan that this animal does not have rabies and has not gone anywhere to contract it in that time period.
So if the quarantine isn't done stateside, what are the options for doing quarantine in Japan?
So if you get, say you get your orders late and you're unable to do the 180 days at home with your pet, when you get here to Japan, you have three options. One, depending on the length of time, if you're still in the Navy Lodge and you're doing your house hunting. Two, if you're going to be on base living, then you can quarantine with your pet on base. Three is to use the next kennel. It has a limited amount of space, so you can try there, or a home share. It's basically where people will offer their homes. If they don't have pets themselves and they live on base, they can watch your pet for you. Now, the big thing is that your pet cannot leave the base because we have worked in agreement with the government of Japan stating we're doing a working quarantine on base. So you're not allowed to interact with other dogs or leave the installation.
Got it. Thank you. And what are the consequences if someone breaks that quarantine?
The biggest one is that we would be violating our contract with the government of Japan, meaning that if it happens consistently, pets would no longer be allowed to PCS with families.
Right, right. Okay, and I'd just like to remind the listeners that more discussion about this topic will be had later in the Welcome Aboard miniseries, where we'll be talking about travel, transportation, just hitting on more aspects about PCSing. Now we'll be moving on to our next topic, and today we have with us HM1 Samo and Lieutenant Horning. Welcome to the show. Both here to discuss the overseas medical screening and why it's so important to get that done. Could you tell us a little bit about that?
Sure. So overseas medical screening is a pretty comprehensive review of your medical status and the care that you receive, you and your dependents. And we do it primarily, not just because it's per instruction, but to ensure that we have the adequate resources to care for you and your dependents when you arrive here on the ground. As we're well aware, we have a much more limited range of facilities, limited number of providers, and a limited number of options if we can't care for you at the MTF here on base. So we want to make sure that when you get here, we can take care of your medical and educational needs to the standard that your family expects.
Thank you. And if someone were to not go through the overseas medical screening, would that have any impact on the dependent entry approval?
Yes. So the dependent entry approval is issued after recommendation from medical. So if somebody were not to go through the dependent medical screening, they would not be able to be command sponsored here OCONUS. That would affect their ability to register for TRICARE overseas, and it would affect their ability to get a SOFA status stamp in their passport. So if a family member wanted to visit, they don't need to necessarily do an overseas medical screening. They could come and do a normal visa to visit Japan. and that would be fine. But if they wanted to live here, they really need to complete this overseas screening process. It's critical for housing, medical care, education, and SOFA status.
Thank you. And it's required for all dependents, right?
It is.
Okay. Well, when should you start the screening? At one point in the PCS process?
To avoid hyperbole, I'm going to say the day you get your orders.
As fast as possible. Okay.
There is a timeline, and I think HM1 can talk about that.
Yes. Per BUMED instruction, the CEO of the transferring command must ensure all service members are screened within 30 days upon receipt of orders and 60 days for family members.
Thank you, HM1. And how does one get the screening started?
So the service member and family member should go to their local MTF and see the suitability screening coordinator and get the forms necessary. So there's plenty of forms that they need to fill out. They have to see the provider. And if there's any medical inquiries, it has to be forwarded to the gaining command to give a suitability recommendation from the gaining command.
Thank you.
There are some unique situations where somebody may be in a remote area and receive all their care from a civilian facility. In cases like that, we don't require them to drive if the MTF is more than an hour away. They're not required to go to that MTF. They can actually contact our office here in Japan through their sponsor, receive all the appropriate paperwork, and take that to their civilian provider in their remote area to get that filled out. That would then get forwarded to us, and our providers here would take a look at it, and if they had any questions, we would get in touch with them and try and get some more clarification on that. But if somebody is stationed in a remote area and doesn't normally have any access to an MTF, that's not a deal breaker at all. That's something we handle quite often.
Okay, got it. And are there any specific requirements for the Exceptional Family Program?
So the Exceptional Family Member Program is a little bit adjacent to this process. As I'm sure you're aware, it's governed by the DOTI instruction 1315.19. It's a mandatory program, but being on EFMP does not preclude you from an overseas assignment. In fact, now each and every person is screened individually regardless of their category of EFMP. And there have been many cases recently that we have been able to support even Category 4 and Category 5 family members here in Yokosuka.
Thank you. And where would I go for more information if I needed it?
So your MTF EFMP coordinator will have that, but each unit actually does have an EFMP coordinator who can get you all the information and get you all the points of contact you would need.
All right, thank you. Is there anything you think I missed? Any important topics that you'd like discussed?
The one thing I would say is if you forget everything else we've said, remember these three things. Start early.
Right.
Be thorough. And be patient with us, and and we will get you processed, and we'll get you on your way to Japan if that's the best place for you.
Oh, thank you very much, sir. We'll be moving on to one more topic, and that is the passport requirements and processes for no fee and tourist passports. And joining me for that is Ms. Luann Dyson. How are you doing?
I'm doing great. Thanks for having me.
So, just to start off, who needs a passport to PCS to Yokosuka?
So if you're talking about special issuance passports, that depends on the foreign clearance guide. So anyone who has travel orders overseas, they should first look at the foreign clearance guide to see who is required to have one, who is authorized to have one, because those are two different things.
Right.
To go to Japan, though, if you are military personnel, it really depends on your command that you're going to and then the billet that you're assigned to. For military dependent, all military dependents who are eligible, usually U.S. citizens, are required to have it. And then civilians, DOD civilians, and their dependents are required to have it.
So what are the requirements for getting one of these passports?
So for the special issuance passport, you have to be on travel orders. You have to have a travel authorization to receive one.
Okay. And what's the difference between the no-fee passports and the tourist passports?
So the no-fee passports or the special issuance passports, they are used for official government travel. And then the tourist regular fee passports, those are used for personal leave travel.
Thank you. Do you need a no-fee passport to travel to Japan? Do you just need to have one signed up for?
So per the foreign clearance guide for Japan, if you are a military dependent, you do not have to travel with a special issuance passport, but you have to apply before you begin your travel. So that's one big thing that is always like a big question. You can travel with your tourist passport as long as you've applied for the no-fee special issuance passport.
When should you start the process for applying for a passport?
As soon as you receive your PCS orders, you can apply for the special issuance passport.
I see that's a trend. Yeah.
Yes, do not wait, because it does take, depending on the time of the year, it takes about 6 to 8 weeks for processing time. Or 4 to 6 weeks. So usually like the summertime is when it's longer, like 6 to 8 weeks.
Right,
and then
right.
Like when PCS season starts to die down, then it's like 4 to 6 weeks. So the sooner the better.
If you're in Japan currently and your passport expires, where do you go to apply for a new one?
So you would go to your nearest government passport office. So if you're in the Yokosuka area or the Atsugi area, It would be the government passport office at the PSD TSC building, 1555, on Yokosuka main base. There are other bases that you can look up their passport office information.
Thank you. And what if you've either gotten married or had a kid? How would you process their passport?
So if you have an eligible dependent, a U.S. citizen dependent, you can definitely stop by the government passport office and ask for a checklist on what is required, or you can email our group email address, m-yo-psdpassport@fe.navy.mil, and we will definitely send you a reply with the checklist.
Thank you. Well, that just about hits all the topics we needed to discuss today. Hope you learned a little something about the PCS process. I know it can be a bit difficult to find out what or who you need to talk to and how to get the ball rolling. If you have any questions about the PCS process, or you're coming to Yokosuka and need to know a little bit about what to expect, check out our CNIC page at cnrj.cnic.navy.mil. Then you'll select Yokosuka from the drop-down menu. If you have any suggestions or inquiries, send us an email at yokosukareport@gmail.com or message the Commander Fleet Activities Yokosuka Facebook page. Thanks for listening, and I hope you have a great day.
The Giant Voice Podcast is a production of Commander Fleet Activities Yokosuka Public Affairs Office. The views expressed in this podcast do not necessarily reflect the policy of the Department of the Navy or Department of Defense. Thanks for listening.